thank you very much for joining us here for the CNBC TV 18 PwC GST Decoded Conclave. My many thanks to our guests here who join us this evening to discuss the year that's gone by as well as what we can expect for GST on the road ahead. Thank you very much, Mr. Badal, for joining us from Chandigarh. I know you were meant to be here, but unfortunately you couldn't join us in person here in Delhi, but appreciate you joining us here from Chandigarh. Mr. Isaac, thank you for coming all the way down from Kerala to be with us here today. And Mr. Godino, appreciate you coming down from Goa to join us here at the GST Conclave. I know Mr. Singh has also arrived from the Northeast early this morning, so we appreciate your presence here at our conclave as well. So let me kick things off, and Mr. Isaac, let me start by asking you, sir, you know, one of the achievements of this year that we've seen is that politics, while may play out outside, at the level of the GST Council, politics has been kept aside. There has not been a single occasion, the 27 meetings of the GST Council, where there has been a vote. All decisions have been taken unanimously. This is a mechanism that has given India hope that a federal structure can in fact work, can in fact deliver. What has been the experience on the GST Council, sir?
I think that is the best of the lot.
That's the best, is it?
In the sense, we in the GST councils have very different position on many issues. And we have evolved a method of consensus decision making. Mm. There is a give and take. But that doesn't deter me from having my criticism against the GST structure. And even more forcibly, the experience during the first year. It has been a rather a disappointment to me.
Okay.
What we set out, we have very far away from that. Mm. To start with, there has been very significant reduction in the incidence of tax rate. Something like 40% on the average. But that is not reflected in the prices.
Okay.
The ordinary people of India has not drawn any advantage from GST. So that is the one major issue.
Okay.
Secondly, then of course there are clauses in the law like anti-profiteering clause, etc. But they have proved to be very ineffective.
Okay.
Secondly, you must accept the small scale sector, unorganized sector. They're in deep trouble. Mm. Of course, a concession has been made in raising the threshold of the presumptive tax level. But nevertheless, once you want to trade with the organized sector, you have to come into the GST. Mm. And they would lose the kind of comparative advantage they used to have in the pre-GST period.
Okay.
And there has been, we cannot do anything there within the tax system, but our outside direct support systems for the SME sector has to be improved, and there has no signs of that.
Okay. But so you made several points there. You're saying that overall this experience in the past 1 year has been a disappointment. Your biggest concern is that the benefit that should have accrued to the ordinary consumer, to the citizen, has not come through. So who do you hold responsible for that? Do you believe that industry hasn't passed on enough?
Let's be very frank. From the first day I was in the GST Council, this is one issue I've been raising. The position taken by the business was, I remember the presentation of Vicky and so on, that competition will take care of the issue. Hmm. I said, no, it's an oligopolistic market in India, and therefore price determination is not based upon perfect competition.
But it hasn't had an adverse impact on inflation, sir. I mean, you know, the expectation was that perhaps GST would have had an adverse impact on inflation. That hasn't been the case either as well.
Well, one can decompose an exercise of what are the contributions to the inflation in India has not been done by anybody. But the fact remains, say in Kerala, for example, 80% of the commodities used to suffer 14.5% VAT. Mm. And now a comparable number of commodities, the proportion is only 15%.
Okay.
That's the kind of sharp reduction in the incidence of tax that has taken place.
Okay.
But suppose the expectation was the gains would be shared with the consumer. Consumers have been cheated. And personally, from my right, I've been involved from GST deliberations right from the late 2000,
yeah,
when it was first introduced in the empowered committee.
Yes.
And now we knew there is going to be constraints on state government resource mobilization,
sure,
autonomy. But the expectation was that, one, the SGST component, the tax which are not in the interstate,
sure,
trade, you could leave it in a band so that a state government wants to have more resources, they should have the freedom. See, me from Kerala, we have chosen a path of development which is focused upon social sector spending.
Yeah.
And which has done us good.
So you're saying it's basically taken away the flexibility and the autonomy of the states to want to be able to raise and mobilize revenues of your own. I'll come back to you in just a second, but let me go across to the Finance Minister of Punjab, Mr. Manpreet Badal. Mr. Badal, Thomas Isaac here saying that the biggest achievement of the GST has been the workings of the GST Council. That has been the single biggest hit as far as he is concerned. What to your mind has been the single biggest hit of the GST rollout in the past 1 year? And the miss. And I know your list of misses is going to be longer than the list of hits, but I'm hoping you'll start with the hits.
Well, for a start, what the GST Council has done, it's created a fraternity of finance ministers, and we sit together and we share our experiences and best practices of the state. Like last month, I had a team from Punjab actually visit Kerala to study their lottery system. Next week, a team from Punjab is actually going to West Bengal to study their excise policy. So this has been a great experience. Having said that, I think also the fact that in a very diverse country like India, the fact that we were able to implement the GST, you know, in a country so diverse,
yeah,
I think I would give it an 8 out of 10. And
okay,
also pay my tribute to Mr. Chidambaram and Pranab Mukherjee Saab and the whole 10 years. But having said that, I feel that, you know, when this was once in a century legislation, where we totally were transforming the tax system from the tax administrator to payer and all, and we were told that we will simplify the whole process. It will give a boost to our economy or GDP, and it will also boost tax revenues.
Yeah.
So all three things have not taken place. And when we talk to the stakeholders, there are, you know, everybody, there are irritants basically.
Okay.
And some people actually rejected it outright.
Expected.
And like,
I
Mr.
Mean,
Isaac,
fair, Mr. Badal,
he said that small businesses have...
Sure, small businesses have suffered. I think there is consensus on that. But if I could dial back to the months or the weeks ahead of the GST rollout, I mean, till the very last day, you know, the consensus was that this is going to be a disaster, that things will fall apart even before it actually takes off. Let's be clear. You know, while there have been teething troubles, there has been pain on the ground as far as SMEs are concerned. There have been technology glitches. There have been issues with respect to filing. Compliance burden has gone up. But, you know, the country has moved on. The transition has happened. And things are now moving back to the normal that we were before the 1st of July last year.
Sure. I'm not saying that mistakes, you know, anybody can make mistakes. Mistakes are made, and then, but all I'm trying to put across is that we must, A, acknowledge the mistakes,
yeah,
keep our ears to the ground, and we must have an honest feedback from the stakeholders.
Sure.
And once we do that, because my motto is, nothing less than perfection in the design and implementation of the GST is acceptable. You know, if India has to become a superpower, and within, you know, my lifetime, and I hope I have another 10 years to live, then we must design it in such a way and implement it in such a way. I mean, after all, GST is a tax which is implemented in about 100 other nations of the world. We can actually go to the, you know, what are internationally recognized as the best practices. And as long as we are willing to listen to each other and this spirit of cooperative federalism is taken to a next level, we will, you know, there are 200 changes in the law which are coming up. And if some time is given rather than rush through the legislation, otherwise we're bound to make the same mistake.
Mr. Godino, let me ask you, sir. I know that you've consistently believed that things will improve when it comes to both revenue collections as well as the compliance burden easing out. We are still waiting for that simplified form. My sense is that it is expected in about between August to October is the timeline that the government is working with at this point in time. But give me a sense of what a state like Goa has experienced in the first year of the rollout and what next can we expect?
I think it's not only Goa, the whole country is impacted by GST, as you know. And if we look at our journey in the last 1 year, I can safely say that during the 1 year, the way it has been implemented, the way GST has worked, it has been a splendid legislation in indirect taxation, which is working very well. And when I say working very well, you look at the collections. Collections are not bad. There were so many pessimists in the beginning who said it will never work, it will crash right in the 3 months' time, 4 months' time.
But, sir, let's be honest, collections have been under what you were estimating as well. You're grudgingly saying, but the fact of the matter is that they have been below what your own estimate was.
No, when you work in a big country like India, and when you know we have lowered the rates, listening to the common man, looking at the common trader, the small businessman, we have taken their opinion into consideration. Wherever it hurts them, we have not hesitated, even though knowing well we will lose revenue, to lower the rates. The emphasis has been to give him give more relief to the common man. Any country brings any legislation, whether it is financial or otherwise, ultimately what is it? We want to have a better system than what was already there. We want to give relief to the businessman. We want to give relief to the common trader. And as I would describe, at the end of 1 year, GST, I would call it garibon ka sochne ke baad tax, and I would like to
the good and simple tax has now become garibon ke sochne ke baad wala tax.
Yes, because I would also like to describe that, because we have thought about the common man. You see, food grains are out of the ambit of GST. Items which impact the common man are out of the GST ambit. Those items which are most commonly used even by the middle class and the nation as a whole or the large population, you have the lowest bracketing of tax towards those particular goods. That means we have always thought about the common man. Now, while looking at this, we have to also look at the revenues, we have to look at employment generation, we have to look at investments into infrastructure, into the overall growth and overall buoyancy in the economy as well as the revenues. So many things are to be balanced. One fails, sometimes we fail to realize India is a combination, if I may say so, as I've said it earlier also, a combination of not only 27 states. I call them like it almost becomes like a combination of several countries. The smaller countries, even though in 100 countries we have been able to implement a reform like this, they have been smaller countries with a smaller population. We are so diverse, we have so many diverse views, we have a very healthy and robust democracy where everybody is so robust in his views and expressing those views so strongly, even economically, that you sometimes feel whether consensus will arise.
But to the credit of
the GST Council, though people belong to different political parties, They thought about India as one country at that point of time. I want to compliment every political party. And this is something which has to be applauded. Normally, I would say this type of spirit builds up during wars and when all Indians unite. But here was one reform where all Indians united. Why don't we look at that? Sure. And to take these decisions also, you need guts. You need out-of-the-box thinking. You really need to take a risk in your economy. our leader, that is, means whether Narendra Modi ji has taken this risk in the, risking his political, so many things politically.
Okay.
It's not so easy on the back of demonetization. You have the GST being introduced and it's still working at the end of 1 year.
Mm.
Though now, obviously, opinions will slightly change. They will be tempered because of the coming Lok Sabha elections. It's bound to be that way.
No, no,
it has to be that
mean,
way.
Sir?
It is,
what
it
does
is
that mean?
It is democracy working at its best. So
no, no,
I would
I want
grant
to
it to the people who would
mean.
Contest those
So we
opinions.
Shouldn't expect anything more now on the GST till the Lok Sabha elections are over and done with?
No, I said there are always dynamic situations. They need a dynamic response. And our government is dynamic enough, taking everybody on board to take those right decisions, which will further simplify GST
okay.
and make it easier for the businessmen and the community at large to sort of dwell
okay.
themselves
okay.
into the GST regime.
Well, Mr. Singh, let me come to you now, because the GST Council signs off on the decisions, and it is the CBIC that has to ensure that those decisions are actually executed on the ground. Give me a sense of what the experience has been from an administration and execution point of view. What have been the highs and the lows, sir?
Well, I'd like to inform that Central Board of Excise and Customs, now it is Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, under the Department of Revenue and Ministry of Finance, is responsible for implementing GST in the country in coordination with the state governments. Last 1 year, after 1st July 2017, till now, we are almost completing 1 year, I can tell you honestly, it has been a journey roller coaster ride. We have been in thick of implementing GST, and after 1 year of implementation, I can say with certain amount of satisfaction that it has been a great success.
Okay.
We are aware that there have been glitches, there have been concerns, there have been issues, but our officers, central government officers, and state government officers under Finance Secretary have been always willing to listen to the grievances, the concerns of the taxpayers. We have been going out to the taxpayers. We have been holding outreach programs.
Right.
Yesterday only I was in Guwahati. I can tell you one simple thing, e-way bill. I mean, there is a lot of discussion on e-way bill. Just for the sake of example, I can say, I was talking to transporters there. They were telling that one truck from Delhi to Guwahati, it used to take 15 days.
Mm.
The expenditure, accounted, non-accounted, whatever, used to be 20,000 rupees for one truck.
Okay.
The 20,000 rupees has gone. There is no expenditure. And the truck reaches within 7 days. All barriers on the state, barriers, they have vanished overnight.
Mm.
This is the greatest achievement.
Mm.
If some research or some, you know, study can be done, how much, you know, petrol or diesel we are saving on the trucks. There used to be, you know, 36 hours, 48 hours, you know, queue for miles together on the border just to cross the border, show your papers and enter in the other state. Now, if you start from Kanyakumari, go to Kerala, if you have e-way bill, which you can generate yourself, there is no interaction with the state government officers or central government officers, and you can just flash the e-way bill number, and you can just pass through. Nobody is going to check you.
Mm.
It is the greatest relief to the transporters, to the taxpayers.
Okay, so you're saying one in terms of, you know, doing away with the check posts and the barriers, that's improved the ease of doing business as well as brought down the cost, especially from a logistics point of view. You said that you believe that at the end of 1 year, you can satisfactorily say the GST rollout has been a success. What are the other metrics that you would like to share with us on why you believe it's been a success?
It has been a great success. You know, revenue-wise, you can say, in the for the month of March, April, we collected more than 1,03,000 crore.
But you also caveated that by saying that we don't expect the 1 lakh crore number to be a trend just yet. Do you feel more confident about that now?
It will come. It will come. You know, next year we collected 94,000 crore. It's not a small amount. It's increasing. And you know, it is you know, all doubting Thomases who were saying that, you know, revenue will fall down. It's nothing of the sort happening. Actually, it's going up.
Mm.
And we are taking measures. Even now, we are conscious of the facts of the problems of the people. We are conscious of the problems which the taxpayers are facing. Our officers, state government officers and CBIC officers are deployed every nook and corner of the country. Small, small places, we have range offices.
Mm.
Our commissioners are sitting in faraway places like Aizawl and Imphal. And, you know, they are always willing, they are ready, they are available, they are accessible to listen to the grievances of the taxpayers and solve those problems. We have a very robust mechanism to address those problems. We have various committees.
What are you most concerned about today? You gave me a long list of why you believe the rollout has been successful. What are you most concerned about even today?
Well, one thing which is bothering us is the compliance from the taxpayers.
Mm.
We, being in India, everybody knows, I don't want to mince words, we are hesitant to pay taxes as Indians, right? So it is a great challenge to bring the people, to convince them that if you pay tax, it makes life easy for you.
Mm.
It
so adds now are you going to make life difficult?
If they don't pay taxes, if they want to avoid taxes, they make life difficult for themselves.
Mm.
They are doing great harm to the nation also. We have mechanism to convince them, and we are trying continuously to convince them.
Are you running out of patience, or do you still have more patience? My question is very pointed. Are we now going to see some serious enforcement measures coming into play? Vanita Sarna said that we'll wait to use the danda, but has the time now come to use the danda is the question.
Shereen, we don't want to use the word that we'll use danda. But, you know, as you will agree with me, we'll run out of patience. Right?
You have run out of patience.
We will.
You will, okay.
I mean, so there are, you know, there are methods, there are means just to convince the taxpayers, and it is for their benefit.
I mean,
if you pay taxes, you do the compliance, life is much more easier for you.